Okay, so it's I'm very happy that that you came to our webinar, and today I have selected two topics, namely intersections, unions, differences of paths, and transformations. Yeah, okay. The draft of this script is already available. If you go to Docs, if you go to Docs and previous webinar sessions, you will find volume 4, and there's the PDF. So let's start. Okay, as always, at the beginning of the script, I include a skeleton page how to start programming JSX Graph. And now we start with intersection, union, and differences of path. So a path in the following can be a circle, a curve, which are also function graphs or curves, and polygons in JSX Graph. So, and of course, we all agree that sometimes it will be necessary to overlap, to visualize the overlapping regions of some curves or paths. And of course, this can be done with a simple fill opacity. So here's an example. Here we have two circles, which with fill color. Each one has a different fill color and a certain opacity. And the intersection is visible through the overlapping of the opacities. So here we have a fill opacity of 0.6. In both cases, we have a red circle and a yellow circle. And this is done by the system, by SVG or by the browser, that then the opacities add up a little bit. Okay. This is the poor man's intersection of curves. Of course, this doesn't help too much. And sometimes it will be, or often it will be necessary to have this intersecting object, this intersection object, as a curve object itself. And this is possible since, let's say, version 1.2. And in computer science, this is called clipping. Well, and at the moment, it's a little bit complex, or you have to do some low level programming to do it. It might be that we add more comfortable ways to intersections in the future. And when we implemented it, I found out that clipping of paths seems to be surprisingly a complex operation. So the algorithm we implemented is Greiner-Hormann algorithm, which was published as late as 1998. And the improved algorithm was just published in 2019, which handles degenerate intersections. And interestingly, if you have two polygons, for which you want to have the intersection, then a degenerate intersection is if one vertex of the one path is on the edge of the other path. This is called degenerate. And these are the difficult cases. And the correct way to handle it was just published in 2019 for this Greiner-Hormann algorithm. So, and the implementation in JSScript is quite new. So if you find cases where it doesn't work, please submit them at GitHub or at Google Groups. So what we have to do is to access these new clipping methods is we start with an empty curve, like in this example. So again, we have the same two circles as in the trivial example before. And now we start with an empty curve, no points given. And we populate this update data array method. And here we call the intersection JXG math clip intersection method and supply it with the two curves, the two paths which we want to intersect, and add a reference to the board. And the return value of this method intersection is an array consisting of the X coordinates and the Y coordinates of the intersection polygon, intersection curve. And then at the end, you have to update it once to call for the initial call of this method update data array. So let's see it in an example. Here it is. So here this blue one is a path consisting of the intersection of the two circles. We can drag it and have an empty intersection and so on. And we also have a union. The union of the two curves, or the difference. And difference is always first curve minus the second curve. Okay, so like this. This is the first approach to clipping. And this example used two circles, but you can also use you can use a function graph or a curve and a circle or a polygon or mix. It doesn't matter which combination you are using. So here's an example of a function graph. So this is x squared and a circle. Maybe one thing I had to notice, or you may notice here in the previous example, I had to adjust the layer because in the default, the layers of a circle are above that of curves. So, and here's the example for function graph and circle, and you can get the intersection and of course also the difference. Here's the difference. And I hope this is a useful feature which can be used in many contexts. So, from this JXG math clip, from this JXG math clip functions, we can use another function, another method, namely the winding number. This may be useful for testing if a point is inside of a polygon. So for example, this point A is outside of this green polygon, and if I move it inside, it's in. And this polygon shape may be highly complex, which I mean with may circle around them. There may be holes in it, or maybe maybe a very complex shape. And this winding number is very precise in this can very precisely determine if the point is inside of the polygon or outside. And the winding number, like the name suggests, determines how often, if you start at one point at the polygon and travel around the polygon edges, along the polygon edges, how often you circle around the point in question. So here it's zero time, and here's two time. Now, here's one time, so sorry. And as long as this winding number is odd, the point is considered as inside of the polygon, and if it's odd, it's if it's even, it's considered as outside of the polygon. Yeah, you may use it. So in the script now, there's still an error, a typo. You have to add this clip to this clip here. I will do it later. Okay, this was about clipping. I guess it's quite easy to use. Maybe we will add even more easier methods in the future. The next topic I want to talk of is transformations. This is a typical school topic, namely computation of reflections or mirror elements. Well, let's start with an example. Here we have a line, and we reflect this polygon and this circle along at this line. And here I have to say sorry, or maybe I can ask for your help. Sorry, I didn't look at the chat. Good question again for clipping. How about using the clipping object as data array for a new curve object directly? I guess it doesn't work for the moment, but we can, I'm not sure at the moment, but we can introduce it, yes. Transformations, reflections. Actually, can someone type in the chat how you call it in an English speaking school if you reflect, which I would say in German, reflect a triangle along or at the line? How is the correct English expression? Does anybody know this? Reflect in the line. Okay, thank you. And what about if we can I also reflect it in a point? Okay. So, yeah, here's an example. This is a point reflection, so to say. How is it called in English? About the point, okay. Okay. Yeah, good. Very helpful. So, you get the concept. I reflect a triangle about or in the line. So the same with a circle. This is called a Euclidean transformation because lines will become lines again. Polygons are polygons again, and circles are circles again. And the angles stay constant. And this is done in JSX graph with a new element or with the element reflection, if it's a line, or mirror element if it's a point. If it's about a point or about a line. So we have some, here we start with a line and we have a polygon and a circle, and the polygon and the circle are reflected about or in the line. And the same for the point. Okay. This is one way to realize transformation, or this is one kind of transformation which are possible in JSX graph, and which are possibly used if you do some geometry in school. So JSX graph allows more complicated different transformations. Namely, we can define a transformation and then let this transformation act on some objects, let's say a point, line, circle, curve, polygon, or also images or texts. And we have three possibilities to use a transformation. Let's start with an example. For example, here we have we define a transformation. We create a new board objects or JSX graph objects transformation with the keyword transform. We give some data and supply the type of the transformation. Here it's a rotation. And depending on the type, you have to supply some parameters. Namely, here it's the angle given in radians. So, here it's a function depending on this slider. And this slider goes from 0 to 2 times pi. Okay. And such a transformation can be used in three ways. Namely, we can apply it once to an object. We can bind this transformation permanently to an object, or we can create a new object, which is the result of this transformation on a base object. Okay, let's start with the first example. Namely, we apply a transformation just once. Yeah, here it is. This is maybe even too complex. I make it simpler for the beginning. So this rotation is a transformation of type rotation, and we just rotate by math pi divided by 2. So it's a rotation around 90 degrees, a rotation of 90 degrees. So let's do it. So maybe we see the original status without transformation. So in the beginning, this point A is located as is here, 2, 0. And if we apply the rotation, if we apply the rotation of 90 degrees, then it's here, okay? It's always counterclockwise and it's always around zero. So, and the same can be done with the slider. And here we start with math pi divided by 3. So a 60 degree rotation, it's here. And it's done only once. So this slider has no influence longer, any longer. So it's just a one-time transformation. Okay, so maybe we use just, yeah, now we'll do it like this. Oh, here. So, okay. In this respect, apply once has the same effect as dragging the object with a mouse or with a pointer or moving it with move two. It's the same result. You manipulate this object once. So this is the first application of a transformation. The second one is we can bind a transformation to an object. Let's look at an example. So here is nearly the same situation. And I make it simpler first. So we have the same situation. We define a transformation, the same transformation, depending on the slider. And we bind it to this point A. And now, whenever I move, the slider changes the, I have to do it again. If I, on every update of the board, the transformation is updated. So the correct angle is calculated, or so the rotation angle of the transformation is updated and the transformation is applied to this base object, which is at 2, 0, and the new position is determined. Okay. As I said, rotations are always around zero, around the origin. So what can we do if we want to have a rotation around a different point? Well, we have to translate the object first. So here's a translation about a translation of the point A by 1, 1. So if I update the board, then A moves from 2, 0 to 3, 1. And yeah, okay. So, the next thing, the inverse translation is -1, -1. This is this translation, okay? So the correct way to do the translation, so if you want to, if you want to rotate around 1, 1, uh, if you want to do this, we have first to move the rotation center, so the 1-1 to the origin, then rotate and then move everything back. So it's like this. We first move the rotation center to the origin, or we move A by the translation of the center to the origin. Then we do the rotation and then we rotate back. And then it rotates around 1-1. Okay. Yeah. So we have two transformations, or three transformations at the moment. In this example, rotate and once rotate and two translates. And the order of the binding matters. This is important. So as we saw, an object can receive several transformations. And if you want to do some hacking, so whenever an object has some transformations bound to it, then these are stored in the object sub-object transformations. So if you want to, you may manipulate it directly for some reason. And for the math freaks among us, so applying transformations is a non-commutative operation. So the order in which you bind them to the object, they matter. And the first, which is bound to the first transformation, which is bound to the object, is applied as first transformation. So, okay, these were the two methods to use transformation. Now the third one is this. Exactly the same, nearly the same situation. Again, I have the slider, I have a point, and now I create a second point, and as the result of applying some transformations to the point A. So B is the result of applying some transformations to the point A. So it's nearly the same as make it dependent as applying here some functions where the dependency of B is modeled. So here the same. The same result. B also rotates around 1-1, around the point 1-1. But it depends on A. So if I increase or change the position of A, the path of B changes too. So the radius changes in this case. Okay. And then in the next example, we do this for a polygon. So here, we have again a line. We have a line, this line, and we create a transformation, namely a reflection about this line. And we start with a polygon, P1, the yellow one, and the green polygon is the result of reflecting P1 about the line. So, okay, here whenever I change the polygon, the line, the the reflected polygon changes too. So this is a low-level application of transformation of a Euclidean transformation where we had this reflection element before. So and you can apply transformations also to images and texts. In our wiki, we have some examples of using transformations on text and images. You can see the examples there. I don't want to do it now. beware. So in there's one problem in if you do these Euclidean geometry transformations, the result of reflecting a circle will be again a circle. You can change this in the attributes. You may have, you can look it up in the documentation. This, but usually by default, the result of a reflection, reflecting a circle will be a circle again. But for general transformations, this is not longer true. So, there might be transformations which transform a circle into an ellipse or a hyperbola. And so in general, the result of a transformation applied to a circle is a curve, an element of type curve, of class curve. So what transformations are available in JSX graph. So we have translate, or shifting an object, scaling an object, reflect, we saw it already, rotate, a shear transformation, and a generic transformation. And for this, I want to supply you with some mathematical background in the last few minutes. So internally in JSX graph, transformations are realized as multiplications with matrices. So the coordinate vectors are multiplied by a matrix. And you might always have wondered why in JSX graph coordinates, the coordinate vectors are always of length 3. So we have a set coordinate. And interestingly enough, we have chosen to set the first coordinate as a set coordinate. this is a system which is called homogeneous coordinates. I don't want to go into that. It makes intersecting of lines very easy and constructing lines through points easy. And it makes handling of transformations easy because transformations are, we will see in a minute, transformations are matrices of size 3 times 3 and vectors are coordinates are vectors of size 3, though we can multiply the matrix with a vector. And you may have heard that matrix multiplication is non-commutative. So this makes it clear why the order of binding the transformation is important. Because, the order in which you multiply matrices is important. And in SVG or canvas graphics, they also have transformations. Well, actually, I'm not sure about canvas, but I'm for sure for SVG. But they have a different numbering of the coordinates. So they use X, Y, Z. Yes. So also the transformation matrices are a little bit different. Namely, the first row becomes the last row in SVG, and the first column in JSXdoc becomes the last column in SVG, and then the entry 00 becomes 33. So you have to shift around a little bit. And what is this set coordinate? You can simply think of it. The set coordinate is always one, except if the point is an infinite point. If it's infinitely far away, then it's zero. Okay, and I want to show you a few of these translation matrices. So a translation matrix in JSXgraph has this form, multiplying just mean, so the A, there's an A here and a B here. And this is also, this A and B is also what you have to supply as parameters of this transformation in JSXgraph. And this means the X coordinate is shifted by A and the Y coordinate is shifted by B. If you use a scale matrix or scale transformation, then you have also two parameters, A and B, and A multiplies the X coordinate and B the Y coordinate. Rotation is something with cosine and sine. I don't want to go into this. And shear is looks like this. So X to X, some multiple of Y is added, and to Y, some multiple of B is added. And the generic transformation is there. You have nine coordinates, and if you supply nine numbers for these nine coordinates, something happens. It's transformed to something. And for this, I want to show you an advanced example. So in Germany, we watch a lot of soccer in TV. And I don't know if you are aware of soccer, so football in England. There's the offside rule. So it depends if somebody shoots a goal, it depends, well, where the other players are, if this is a correct goal. Let's have a look at an example first. So to show this offside rule, to visualize this offside rule, we look at the following situation. So in the stadium, there's a camera which films this soccer field. And there's a player A here. And of course, the image which the camera films, which the camera captures, we don't see a rectangle here. It's some distorted view of the rectangular soccer field. This would be the correct view of this soccer field, or model view, if the camera would be high above in the sky, directly above the soccer field. So if you have this model view, it's easy to draw, for example, a vertical line or an orthogonal line here, orthogonal to the edges of the field. It's easy to draw this line, but it's not so easy to draw it here directly in the camera. So what we see on TV is, however, what we see on TV, what we are presented with, is this the correct position of this line. And if the player moves, this line moves too. Okay, how can we do this? The first thing is we will compute a transformation which transform this rectangle into this rectangle and this quadrangle, the above quadrangle, the camera quadrangle to the model quadrangle or the rectangle. Okay. Yeah. Okay, the offside rule is definitely advanced. Yeah, this is true. I will tell it in a moment. So first we compute this transformation from this soccer field to this soccer field. Then we, and of course the position, we also apply this transformation to this point A. So this is a new point A in this this model view. Then we compute the offside line, and then we transform everything back to the original view, the point again and the offside line. And this can be done for different view too, okay? And the example is here. I cannot go into the details, but I will show you how we can do it a little bit. We give you a glimpse of it. So we start with a polygon here in the camera image. This is the original polygon here. Then we start, as the next thing is we define the rectangle in the model view. And in this example, I directly make a copy of the first polygon in the third image. We could do it with the transformation too, but in version 1.21, it's not possible to make transformations of polygons across different boards. Okay, not so. This is a side problem. Then the transformation is computed in this function. I don't want to go into it and say more than that. If you have 4 points as pre-image and 4 points as image, the determination of these 9 coefficients here, is a linear system. For this you have to solve a linear system of equations consisting of 13 inequalities and 13 equations and 13 unknowns. And the system is set up here somehow. And here's the right-hand side of the problem. And then it's solved with a Gauss algorithm. And okay, this is the first transformation. This is just a vector containing these 9 numbers. And and then the inverse transformation is always the inverse matrix. So I just compute the inverse matrix and write it again into the correct position of, as a vector. And this is what we do in this update transformation matrix. And then the next step is, and we write the first 9 parameters. They are in this vector X global. And the other 9, the 9 parameters of the inverse transformation are in X2 global. and we generate functions for it to make it dynamically. And then we create transformations. And this is A is the player. We transform the player into the second board here. And then we transform it back, so to say, into the third board. And we also, well, and we easily can construct the line. The line is just the position, the X coordinates of the player A, and the line which starts at the side in this X position. And we also transform this line, and here it is. And this is all. And these are, we don't update, we only update the transformation matrix if we change the first socket field. Then the transformation matrices are updated. Okay, and yeah, you can study this example. It's quite, I think it's a nice example, and it's it's applicated, one must say, every day in German TV. it's applied every day in German TV. So what is the soccer rule? So if soccer player A wants to shoot a goal here, then if he receives the ball, there has to be at least one player of the other team behind this line. So it's not possible that every player of the other team, of team B, so to say, is to the left of A in this situation. At least one player beside the goalkeeper has to be here. This is roughly the offside rule. I don't know if it's really correct, but it's more or less, these are more or less the rules. Okay, this is what I wanted to say today. I hope it was of some interest for you. Do you have some questions? Okay, then if not, I want to thank you that you listened and came by. And the next seminar will be on March 24th not in the same place. I will announce the Zoom location soon. Okay, thank you. Have fun.